Friends, once again welcome you to our CAHO webinar, which we have been holding on very important topics. And this time the topic that we have selected is extremely critical, as the name suggests, which is the hazard identification and risk assessment. We are very lucky to have Keerthi to discuss this topic, who is a consultant to many, many organizations to look at their risk assessment in those organizations. So we requested her to basically take us through this subject, which most of the people in most hospitals, most of the quality people find it little difficult to kind of comprehend how to kind of go about it. So not going to stand between you and Keerthi. So over to you, Keerthi. Please go ahead.
Thank you. So good evening, all of you. So we are here basically to understand what is Hira all about. Hira stands for Hazard Identification and Risk Assessment. Like in hospitals, you find life is the most important thing. In safety, we find hazard is the most important thing. So it's something like life for us. So when we talk about hazard and risk assessment, it's very, very important for us to understand what hazard is and what risk is. So the effort in this particular webinar is with three objectives. One is to give you an information on how do we go about hazard identification after having an understanding of what hazard is all about. Then we get into risk assessment. Hazard is associated with risk, and so we need to assess them. So what is risk assessment? What does it constitute? How do we go about the methodology? And then comes another most important part, is the determination of controls, or determining controls for the significant hazards. So these are the three objectives with which this webinar has been totally made. So I would take you through these three steps. When we talk about hazard or risk, we see that there are various standards across the world. I have chosen OSHA's 18001:2007 version for discussion. The reason being, this is one standard which is dedicated for health and safety. And this is one standard which is recognized worldwide. It's like an international blueprint when we talk about health and safety in any kind of industry. So that's the reason why I have chosen the understanding of Hira through this particular standard. The standard defines hazard as a source, situation, or an act with a potential of harm, or potential for harm in terms of human injury or ill health, or a combination of these. So basically, when we talk about hazard, we need to be quite open to see what is that combination of a situation or a condition, or what are those things which has a potential in and around us, which has a possibility for causing an injury or ill health. This is what hazard is all about. Hazard, when we talk about, there are different types of hazard. Now, various country, various industry have different method to list the hazard. Over the years, having worked in different industries, we felt that there is a need to standardize the approach for identification of hazard. So we did a lot of work and put all of them together and tried to categorize them in very simple manner. So what we have tried to do is put them into physical, chemical, biological, ergonomic, and others category. So what do we mean by physical? Some hazard which you can see, which you can perceive, and you can see that it has resulted in an injury, will basically fall into physical hazard. For example, maybe fall from height, it is cut injuries, etc. Now, when we talk about chemical hazard, it is basically to do with chemicals, any type of chemicals, where an inhalation hazard could be there as an inherent thing, or it could be ingestion of chemicals, or it could be on the skin. So hazards are basically getting originated because of the chemicals which are available in and around the workplace. When we talk about biological hazard, this could be microorganisms or macroorganisms, which has a potential to cause infection to them in and around. It could come from various sources, like maybe water, maybe food, maybe waste, or any other thing, infected material itself. But then, biological hazards, we basically try to look at what are the sources of microbial or macro organisms which can cause injury or illness. Let's say a dog bite, a snake bite, is still an injury. When we talk about, let's say, food which has got poison, food poisoned, or it has got bacteria in it, it has got pathogens in it, water, it's contaminated, the drinking water. So that we put it under microorganisms. So microorganisms, so biological hazard has micro or macro, both of them coming under the biological category. Now let's look at ergonomic hazard. This is a little of interest for many people in the hospital industry, especially who are in the office atmosphere, and for those people who have repetitive movement happening. Ergo is basically nothing but a repetitive movement which is happening within the workplace. It could be pulling, pushing, putting, or it could be just sitting across for hours together. So this relates to anybody who has a repeated posture, or they have an awkward posture, or they have lifting of things, or they have something to handle in the sense where they have to lift a weight. So that's handling of materials. So in all this, the common factor is that there is some kind of a repetition in activity, but there is a hazard associated with this. You may not find that in many times in terms of injury, which is external, it could be internal also, or it could have a long-term impact like pain, muscular pain, etc. So ergonomic hazard is also of greater importance to understand. The others category, we try to put it over there because there are many other different types, which is based on type of industry that we look at. Hospitals and categories of hospital and type of facilities that the hospital has, there can be many different types of hazard which comes in picture. So all of them could be put under the others category. Some of the examples to discuss is confined space, occupational hazard, radiation hazard, human behavior related. So all of these, we just put it as examples in others. So let's talk about physical hazard. I'm just getting a little more in detail. If you talk about physical hazard, there can be many things which relate with physical hazard. Work activity. So when I say work activity, somebody is doing in maintenance department a welding job, it is related to work activity. So the physical hazard related to that activity could be that he is hitting against something which while doing welding, he has not seen. Maybe there is some object which is kept nearby, he has not seen, and he's just moving towards and he's hit against. Penetration hazard. He is doing with some tools. He is doing an activity in maintenance department, in utilities. He is doing some activity with the tools, and the tools are sharp in nature. There is a possibility for penetration hazard, where there is a skin injury or a little deeper cuts could be the result of it. Machinery hazard, yes, you must be thinking that this is not possible, but wherever there is a movement in, let's say there's a pump, there is a movement, you deal with fire safety, so you do have a lot of machineries which are equipped in the fire safety department itself. So there is possibility for moving equipments through which there is a possibility for hazards. So machinery hazards are to deal with the moving equipments which has a potential for the hazard. Dust hazard is basically, again, depending on activity, not in all areas. Of course, the hazard called dust could be even in the environment, the work environment. Like Delhi, we do find dust is hard in some of the pockets. So when we talk about dust, we don't have to think where is the source. It is just coming from an activity, or it is just existing in the atmosphere to a level that it can impact. All the time, keep in mind that the output, what you are trying to look at here is, why are we identifying a hazard? It is because it has a potential to cause an injury or illness to a person. So next is thermal hazard. Thermal hazard is to do with temperature. Higher temperatures, maybe it is seasonal factor, or maybe in certain places you have boiler in the hospitals to create hot water line in the hospital facility. So you have exposure to heat, so causing thermal hazards. Electrical hazard, most of you would be familiar, and this is available throughout the hospital because you have electrical lines going on here and there. You have distribution boards, you have electrical room, and so the potential for electrical hazard goes throughout. Next comes the fire and explosion hazard. Over here, it depends on what is the source for the fire and explosion. So what we have done is a deeper analysis of different types of hazard, looking into the sources, looking into the causes, and try to put them all together in a tool, which is with a roadmap coming up. So the next type of hazard is the chemicals. When we talk about chemicals, I put it generally into two, the general chemicals and then the cryogenic. The last one which I've listed is cryogenic. The general chemicals, of course, you have various nature of chemicals. You may have toxic, carcinogenic, corrosive, or it is solvent, acids. So it can be different type of chemicals, and one needs to definitely go a little more deeper to see what is the hazard coming from the chemical when it's available in the work atmosphere. It is not only limited to the labs in the hospital, but it also goes to areas where the chemicals are used for housekeeping. It may be used in the sanitary facilities for cleaning. Many of the hospitals use acid for the ceramic tile cleaning. And not only that, it could also be usage of chemicals for medical purposes at the point of use with the patients. So the hazard related to chemicals need to be identified with a thorough study of MSDS, what we call as material safety data sheet. Now the next type of hazard, which is cryogenic hazard, is of importance to understand only because of one specific nature of cryogenic fluids. So the cryogenic substances are such that it can absorb the heat from the atmosphere and cause a cooler atmosphere around. Like you can see nitrogen, for example, it will create a cooler atmosphere around. You can touch your LPG cylinders at home, you will feel cold. So it means to say that it's absorbing temperature from the around and giving the cooler temperature out. So any fluids, any cryogenic substance which would be available in your work atmosphere, you need to be very clear, you need to be vigilant to identify this hazard in specific as related to chemical hazard. The reason being, they can change the nature and characteristics of the material in and around. You can find in one of the movies, I don't remember the name, where there is a nitrogen cylinder, one of the Hollywood movies, nitrogen cylinder which has actually got bursted, and you find, Terminator. You can find that the Terminator machine is totally frozen because of the nitrogen gas exposure. So that is what the impact that these cryogenic fluids can have. It has a cooling impact on the atmosphere, so causing the change in the characteristics of the material in the atmosphere. So we need to be vigilant to see what, when get exposed, will have a reaction or will change its form from one to the other. The next type, biological category, what we saw is to see that micro and macro, which I've already given you an example. So when we talk about micro and macro, of course, we look at the pathogens, the source being waterborne, soilborne, all of them, which we discussed. The macro could be the pest, which is like insect, mosquitoes, dog, snake, and others. But keep in mind, the Biological hazards are not limited to these sources alone. They could even be infected employees. It could be due to bad sanitation practices or hygiene issues in the hospital or the patients themselves. So there could be other factors also. Important to take here is note that the biological hazards is also one of the categories of hazards which you just can't forego in the process of HIRA. The next category that we have is ergonomics. In ergonomics, I have classified it into two categories. One is the physical type of ergonomics and the second is psychological type. Now, many of them, when they talk about ergonomics, they speak only on physical type, which just includes the repetitive movement relating to a physical injury or illness, and the causes being putting, pulling, lifting, pushing, carrying. These are the activities which could cause in a repetitive manner when conducted, which could cause maybe the pain in the muscles, or it could cause back pain, or it could cause wrist pain, etc. But there's also another important type of ergonomic hazard which you and I are getting exposed to a larger extent today. And that is basically the psychological hazards related to ergonomics, which generally happens because of poor scheduling of the shifts. Basically, somebody is working overtime, or there is insufficient recovery between the shifts. The work demands are too low or too high. And this is true. You must be surprised why I'm saying low. Somebody is just walking on the street, and if you're not alert enough, there is a possibility that you trip over something. And studies says that the alertness is related with the psychological hazard. So basically, we are expected to be on alert. When the work demand is too low, we are quite lethargic in our nature. So there is a possibility of trip hazard or other hazards which are connected with your work environment when you have work demands too low. Then conflicting demands. You have several demands on hand and you don't know which one to prioritize and take it in sequence. So this is also one of the important causes for psychological hazard. And of course, we can't forego the juggling shifts with domestic responsibility. Most of the people today, they do have, especially women, domestic responsibilities are too high. They also have greater passion for work and how to balance these two. So this is another round of psychological hazard that we are getting exposed to. Now, the whole point is why I brought psychological hazards under ergonomics for discussion is my belief is that we need to first identify, be aware of the hazards that we are exposed. That's a step one. And that's when we try to understand to what extent am I exposed to. And then I go to, which is assessment, step two. Then I go to step three, which is the control part of it. So if at all I don't have a mechanism to identify it, I don't have a mechanism to be aware of it, I don't have a system available to tell me, yes, this is a hazard, then we are missing on it. And it's not only missing, we are missing on the controls. That means the productivity, what we are expecting in the industry is largely contributed through this hazard. The others, not much to discuss over here because this is something which we need to figure out type of the industry or type of hospital. And there you can enumerate this other categories much more in nature. So let's say confined space. These are hazards which are basically linked with locked spaces, closed spaces, which has deficiency of oxygen over some time. And you do have a lot of case studies where hazards have happened of a person getting killed because of deficiency of oxygen, maybe in a sewage treatment plant. They had just gone to operate, do the testing, and then the gas got released, and they did not observe it. They have just, it's a confined space, there's no free airflow. That's what I mean to say. So the concentration goes on increasing and your brain may not be able to detect what kind of gas is there, to what extent, and the concentration. So ultimately, there is more possibility of death. So confined space is also one of the dangerous type of hazard. And one needs to dig out to understand if a hospital has this hazard anywhere or not. So next is work environment. I have spoken about physical, chemical, biological, all of them. But work environment itself is another category of hazard, which has the way, the type of work setup that we have, the duration of the work that we have, the kind of work atmosphere that we have, the indoor air quality that we are in. So this is work environment related kind of hazards. And it's very specific to type of work area that you, that anybody is associated with. Maybe somebody is in the lab atmosphere, so the nature of hazard is different. So the work environment hazard for the person there is different. Maybe somebody is in the reception and it's so cold, possibly, in the sense the AC is always on to make the guest coming in comfortable. Maybe the receptionist is not that happy with 20 degrees. So the work environment differs from place to place, and based on that, the work environment hazard gets identified. So another type is non-ionizing radiation. This is basically the Xerox machines that we have, the computer that we work. So there are radiations coming from the mobile that we use. So radiations coming from these particular sources, our bodies are exposed to these radiations. So that is also a type of hazard that we are exposed to. Ionizing radiations are alpha, beta, gamma emitters, which the known sources right now is from the sun directly, or it could be from the X-rays, it could be from any other atomic chemicals that is used in the radioactive chemicals that is used in the medical process. So if such kind of treatments are there, so we need to identify them as hazards. Of course, when we come to the assessment, that's where you think about what levels, is it safe, etc. But when we identify hazards, it is expected that you identify them in total. The levels will be decided later part. The next hazard is occupational hazard. Each of us are in different occupation. Even within hospital, we have so many levels in the hospital organization chart, and then we have so many departments in the organization, all of them working towards together for making business happen. But end of the day, that all of us do have associated hazards with the occupation that we do. So what are such kind of occupational hazards that we are exposed to? Maybe somebody who is operating a diesel generator is exposed to noise if he doesn't take precautions properly, or if the hospital has put up a DG without looking at legal requirements, and you have the acoustic enclosure not being taken care as per the legal requirement, then you land up having a DG which is generating more than 75 decibels, while the norm says it has to be 75 to 1000 kVA capacity. So the occupational hazard example in case of a DG operator could be exposure to the noise. So the impact is different. We'll discuss on the impact. So, but it's important that we also have an eye for the occupational hazard identification. Now, next is the human behavior. Why is human behavior becoming an important part? I can quote an example of the pilots. So in aeronautics industry, so the pilot is made to go through a checklist to understand his behavior before he flies. And that is to check his human behavior. How is he accommodating himself? How alert is he to take the responsibility of the passengers and take his flight forward, safe for all of us? So I have abstracted things from there to have an understanding of relatively how human behavior can be brought into different type of industries when we do Hira. The nuclear hazards is very limited to hospitals, probably, if at all you have exposure from neighbor companies who may deal with this particular type of manufacturing, etc. Or maybe in the zone of 10 kilometers, there's a nuclear power plant. So we need to keep, because I'm just giving you what hazard is. But when we go to understanding how hazard identification is done, I would give you in-depth knowledge on how to look at hazards, how to identify them. So there you will understand the hazard is not something that you identify within the physical boundary that you live. The hazard is something which is also originating from the outside, but having an impact inside the physical boundary of the organization. So that's how you can keep this in mind However, the list what I've shown you is an approach towards standardization in having a uniform understanding for the process of Hira, which many people feel is very complex. And so if at all we simplify it, make it as a standard approach, it would be easier for people to understand, identify, and then get into assessment and discuss about the control measures and ensure that our objective of reducing the level of risk is achieved over a period of time. So towards that, now I will take you through the definition of risk. Till now, we were discussing about hazard and different types of hazard. But we need to understand that hazard is associated with something called risk. Now, hazard is something like a cause, and the effect of that cause is what we call as risk. I have pulled this definition directly from the standard, so you can even see the serial number of the risk, 3.18, what talks about injury and ill health. So what is risk? Risk is a combination of likelihood of an occurrence of hazardous event or exposure and the severity of the injury or ill health that can be caused by the event or exposure. To make it very simple, risk is a two-factor method in our methodology for risk assessment. We consider risk as a two-dimensional factor. One is that it is associated with consequence, which we call as severity. And second is the probability of occurrence. Every hazard is associated with a risk, and the risk is associated with probability and severity. I will go back to the DT operator as an example. I hope everybody is at comfort with that example. When an operator is exposed to noise on a daily basis, when it is starting, so for him, it is, what is the activity running of a DG set? In running of a DG set, what is the person getting exposed to? He is getting exposed to the generation of noise. What is the risk coming out of that? The risk is associated with the likelihood, that is probability of occurrence. The probability of the person getting deaf is very, very low, but it can happen. So what we mean to say, one of the risk, one of the outcome of the hazard of getting exposed to the noise is deafness. And another possibility is sleeplessness. He is getting exposed to higher noise, so he will not be able to sleep. Another possibility is speech interference. And another exposure risk is that he has headache. So if you look at all these different type of risk, you see that the risk has different severity and it has different occurrence. So if you look at the possibility for deafness, the severity is very high, but the likelihood is very low. Not that every person working in DG will become deaf. So when we look at headache, the severity is actually low, but occurrence may be more often, if not every day, maybe once in a week, twice in a week, he's getting headache. So now you can see that risk is a two-dimensional factor. It also now has to be understood that when you do a hazard identification and risk identification, you need to be quite vigilant to the multiple risk that happens over exposure while any activity is done. So one activity have multiple hazards. Each hazard may have multiple risks. So this is something which you need to keep in mind. Some of the examples for the risk is dermatitis, which is probably because of skin problems or skin allergy, which has happened over exposure to chemicals or maybe exposure to some type of dust containing some allergens, eye irritation, allergy, abdominal pain, calves pain, pain in the muscles. These are some of them when exposed to higher temperatures. Electrocution, inflammation, burns, heat stroke, hypothermia, again thermal related risk. Injuries or permanent disability, which is specifically on physical risk. Upper limb disorders like pain, ache in shoulder, forearm, elbow, wrist, fingers. which together in the industry is called as repetitive strain injury associated with the ergonomic risk, hearing impairment or respiratory disorders exposed to dust or this is hearing is noise, and possibility for death. This is some of the examples. While it's quite important to understand that each hazard may have a different type of risk and multiple risks. Okay, so having known about hazard and risk, I would come back to our objective again and summarize our overall approach to Hira. The overall approach to Hira goes in three steps. Step one, identify the OHS hazard and risk. Occupation, health and safety, hazard and risk. Second is do the risk assessment. Third is establish the control measures. So I will take you through each one of these steps. So the process of Hira starts with enumerating the list of hazard and risk for each area. And when we say each area, you may have to do follow a procedure. First, lay down a procedure for conducting Hira in the hospital, and then follow getting into the enumeration of the list. When I say procedure, it's basically to lay down a step-by-step approach, which means first you fix your layout, then you fix your number of departments, then you fix your areas, and then you fix your work activities. And activity-wise, you get into hazard and risk. So this is how you have to drill down yourself to identify the hazard and risk, to generate a list. Now the list would be generated, then you would definitely need a guideline. What is a guideline? Now, as I told you, to do the risk assessment, we need two factors to understand. That's probability and severity of the risk. Now, a range of what is the probability of 1 to 5 probably, or the risk 1 to 5. So what is that range? That can be made very in-depth and very different to each hospital based on the categories of risk and hazards that is availing in the hospital. Based on the levels of the hospital, it could be identified. So there is a need of a guideline to guide us what is our level of the risk. So risk assessment cannot be initiated without the guideline. Some of them may not use a separate document as a guideline. Instead, into the risk assessment sheet itself, probably in the legend, put across what is the guideline factors. That's also fine. So you get into risk assessment, and there you find out what are the significant risks, and you develop the control measures for all those significant. And then now at this stage, you will have your significant hazards, and you will have your controls established over them, which you need to be monitoring from time to time to see the progress of how your hazards and risk has been managed, from which level to which level you've been able to bring them down. So this whole scenario is what we call as the Hira process, which is to be implemented in the hospitals. So now let me take you through all the three steps a little more in detail, basically to give you an insight on how to identify the hazards. I've again taken the quote of 18001:2007 version. The reason behind this is one of the standards, and this is one of the clauses so beautifully laid down in the standard for more than 1.5 page, and it totally relates to hazard and risk. And it, many organizations may not choose to be certified to OSHAs, but I don't want the flavor and content of it being lost for whatever hospitals, whichever hospitals would like to implement Hira. This is one of the best guide to actually consider to do the Hira process. So the standard clearly gives us the guideline. When you do Hira, what are the condition or situation that you have to keep in mind to identify the hazards? So let's go through each one of them. So I have A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. So first is routine and non-routine activities. So which means once I have done the layout mapping, I've listed the departments, I've listed the activities within the departments, and then I come down to understand which of those activities are carried out on a day-to-day basis and which of them are carried out very rare. like maybe preventive maintenance is still scheduled, or breakdown maintenance happens like a non-routine, it doesn't happen every day. So one needs to have a clear understanding. And when we talk about Hira, it's not, we're not only talking about fire safety here. Please bear that in mind. When we talk about Hira, it is for the whole organization that we are talking about. So, and we are talking about everybody within the boundary of the organization. Like it could even include a visitor who has come to visit the patients. It could be somebody who has just come to inquire on something. Or it could be a patient which is inside. It could be a contractor who is working, or a service provider. Or it could be doctors who are on service. Or it could be even some experts who have just come to help. So it is any one of them in the vicinity of the hospital. So when we do Hira, this is meant for everybody. So when you identify hazard, don't ever get afraid, my list is going to 10,000. No, that's not your worry at all. When you identify hazard, keep in mind what you are expected to identify and keep your focus on that. Once you start identifying all the hazards, you have a step to say which of them is significant so that you can establish control only over the significant. But important to understand is that you need to identify all of them. Not decide that this is not significant, this is not important, let's not identify. That cannot be the approach. The simplest of the hazards also need to be identified. So let's look at what are all those things that has to be kept in mind while identifying the hazard. The first is the routine and non-routine activities. So list down or jot down what is carried out on everyday basis and what is something which is done very rarely and very rarely. Maybe 6 months, maybe 10 years, maybe 5 years, but get them on the list. So that's one of the input. Second, activities of all person having access to the workplace, including contractors and visitors. So which means to say contractor must be coming only once in 6 months to lift those used oil containers which you have kept in your scrapyard, right? Which is used for the transformer maintenance. So you are filtering the oil from the DG, from the transformer, pouring it, and then keeping it available in the scrapyard. So your contractor must be coming only once in 6 months to pick it up. But you're expected to identify hazards even for that once in 6 months activity and not leave it just because it's identified by the, it is carried out by the contractor. So that's how you will have to keep in mind. So activities of all person having access to the workplace. Workplace here means to say the physical boundary within which the hospital is located. So number three, human behavior, capabilities and other human factors. So there could be possibilities that some of the employees are from the category of specially abled, or could be they have some mental challenges or challenges of intelligence, etc. One need to identify if there is any possibility of hazard arising out of any such behavior or capabilities. And important to understand, it's not only about those scenarios, also about the mindset of people. In many places, what we see is management takes so much care to provide the PPEs that's required, the best of PPEs that's required, but people don't find it convenient to wear them and to do the work. And so end of the day, what happens is they are exposed to the hazards. So even if you take construction industry, most of the companies which are very reputed, you find them having all the PPEs and the project goes on safe. There also there's possibilities, but then the potential for possibility is reduced. While in the general construction, you can see that people are just barefoot working over there on ground and the scaffolding is not being put. The dust levels are very high in the construction scene. So you can see that this is because of the human behavior. Either the management does not have an attitude to safety, or management would have provided it and the contract workmen don't have the human behavior factor. That means don't have attitude to accept safety as inherent requirement to do work. So this is also one of the factors the standard calls us to consider while identifying the hazard. Whatever is prevalent in your work area, identify them and put so that we are able to control that particular factor. The next is identified hazards originating outside the workplace adversely affecting the health and safety of person within the workplace. Now, this is something was what I was trying to refer to in nuclear. But the example need not have to go so far to the nuclear kind of hazards. Let's look at the scenario. Most of the hospital runs canteen, and it may be so possible that this canteen is outsourced. So there's a greater possibility the food is cooked outside and then it is brought over here and it is served in the canteen. When this happens, there is a greater possibility at the cooking area, cooking place, wherever he has done cooking outside, there is a potential for food poisoning or contaminated water or the hygiene factors, whatever, contributing factors, because of which the hazard has got into the food and the food is carried all the way to the hospital and the people who are eating food in the hospital are within the workplace are getting impacted. So this is how hazard identification went. You need to keep in mind what are those hazards which is happening around and then it can have an impact within the workplace for us. Hazard created in the vicinity of the workplace by work-related activities under the control of the organization. So this is crystal clear and simple. Within the workplace, what all activities are happening, if it is boiler, running of boiler, there is hazard associated with smoke getting generated, temperature, all that. So you need to identify all associated hazards to that. So similarly, your list of work activities will guide you on taking care of the part E. Let's come to F. Infrastructure, equipment, and materials at the workplace, whether provided by the organization or others. Now, this is something which we definitely have to keep in mind because there is a larger possibility that we forget them. So, infrastructure, okay, that's provided by the contractor, it's not my job. So, that's how our possible thinking could be. Or equipment, the filtration happens through his equipment, he brings his filter and he filters the oil and gives it to me. So why should I identify the hazard related to his equipment? But the standard says very clearly the hazard originating from infrastructure or equipment or material which is available at the workplace, whether it is provided by the organization or by the service provider. You need to identify hazards for all of them. Changes or proposed changes in the organization, its activities or materials. One thing we need to keep in mind is that whenever we identify hazards, it cannot be a static activity. I have done it today and that is it. That's going to be my Bible. No. Hazard, the Hira process is a very dynamic process. The standard expects that at the time of the proposal of change, let's say you want to bring a new building, or you want to increase two floors, at the blueprint stage, you're expected to do Hira and then go into the building construction with the controls which come with the Hira process, whatever is output you have got. So that's the expectation of the standard. So changes or proposed changes, whenever it happens in the organization, activity or its materials, Hira has to be updated. Modification to the system, if at all you have done it, or including temporary changes. We may think, oh no, this shifting of cylinder from here to here, the oxygen cylinder is only today's activity, so it is very temporary, it is not going to remain here, so we don't need to know. The standard expects you to identify even temporary changes because you're shifting from here to here, what hazard is extra being carried to that environment and what happens from that environment to this. This is what actually is essential. Now, the point is whether you implement OSHAs or not, but these are the good points coming from the standard, which is available for us for having a good Hira. Now, why is Hira so important for us? Hira is so important because this is like a preventive tool available in our hands to ensure that we are working safe. All the other things like putting process controls or even safety audit for that matter, is some kind of a control just to check whether system is working well or not. But Hira is not like that. Hira is something that you're putting in place as a preventive control so that your whole hospital is safe. So this takes more importance than any of other steps of monitoring and checking. So that's how Hira is very, very critical and important. And while doing Hira, you also need to keep in mind the applicable legal obligations related to risk assessment and implementation of necessary controls. For example, let's go back to that DG operator. Let's say you are doing Hira over there. You've said exposure to noise, and then you have hearing impairment. Now, when you go into the assessment, the levels, and deciding the controls, you need to see, is the law of the land giving you any input related to this hazard and exposure? If yes, then it is essential for you to know, yes, you need to consider the legal requirements before you put your control measures. Yes, in case of DG, there is a legal requirement which I mentioned earlier. So consider it to ensure that your exposure levels are well within the designated norms in the country. So this is what is the summary of step one, identification of hazards. I think we will run short of time, so I will go a little faster from here. We get into step two, which is called risk assessment. In risk assessment, we have an evaluation matrix. That evaluation matrix is guided by two major factors. One is severity and one is occurrence. You can add on factors to this based on type of, you know, the in-depthness and maturity the hospital would carry, like maybe the scale factor, maybe the control factor, etc. But the basic part, which you cannot do Hira without, is ensure that the risk that you have identified is evaluated with severity and probability of occurrence. So internationally, not only OSHA's 18001, there's a standard specifically meant for risk assessment called ISO 33000. Even that gives you these two basic parameters to evaluate the risk. So when we say severity and probability, I've put a very basic guideline for us. What is severity rating mean? It is basically for me to categorize the consequence, what is happening from the hazard, the risk that I've identified is in what level, low, medium, and high. Similarly, when I look at probability, how often can this particular hazard and risk that I've identified can happen? Can it happen every day? Can it happen multiple times a day? To medium or low, which may be once in a year. So what I've given you is indicative, but you can make very beautiful guidelines specific to your hospital, where you can go with timelines of defining maybe 1 to 5 or 1 to 10 for probability and 1 to 10 for severity, and different categories of hazard for severity, like thermal hazards, ergo hazards, physical hazards, chemical hazards. The rating guideline for severity may be different for each one of them. So that's up to the hospitals to define that. Now let's come to step three, which is establishing control. Now this is quite an important step. After having identified what is existing in our work environment and then assessed it to what level it has an influence over us, now it's time to see, how do I establish controls? The earlier versions of the standard had establishing of controls more in a subtle way, allowing people to have more administrative controls, while 2007 version gave it a very clear-cut hierarchical approach. The hierarchical approach is step one, try to eliminate. So is there an elimination of the hazard or risk possible? Can you remove the DG itself? Do you have alternatives? If the answer is no, then you go for substitution. So when I say substitution, possibly, let's say chemical A getting replaced with chemical B, which is less hazardous in nature. Then engineering control. It means to say, okay, I have to go with DG. There's no other option for my emergency. It's a backup. So then what is the other possibility? Is I go with engineering control of acoustic enclosure to the DG. The next is the signage and warnings, which is basically the administrative controls. So here, the administrative controls can go up to a length of defining the work procedure, operation control procedure of how to do work in a safe manner with operating criteria mentioned in it, which actually defines the safe operation in our work area. And then the last one is personal protective equipment. Generally, the trend understanding in the industry is, okay, if there's a hazard, give PPEs. That's absolutely a wrong approach, because you are sorting for the last type of control in hierarchy if you're landing up with PPEs directly. You are expected to first look for options for elimination, substitution, engineering control, look for administrative controls, multiple controls, a combination of all this, and then finally land up with PPEs. This is how establishing of controls happen. So to summarize, I have the significant hazards and risk, and then I have different types of controls which can be identified in organization. Some of the examples like operation control procedures, maybe some management programs where you don't have a complete scrapyard, for example. It is cost intensive because you need to plan how waste management has to happen, how identification, segregation, storage, handling, and disposal and recovery, all these things has to be put in place. So a complete system has to be planned. It requires careful planning, a teamwork, and execution, and also ensure monitoring that's happening with results. So a management program fits it well to put the program in place. And then you may have emergency manual, which most of the hospitals do have. And then you may have monitoring and measurement plan, which helps you understand what performances have to be monitored, which fire extinguishers to be monitored when. So all the fire related, not so please understand, it's not only fire we are talking about, all different types of significant hazards that you've identified in your HIRA. How is monitoring required to any one of them? If yes, then what kind of monitoring, who's going to do it, when it will be done, how it will be done, what's the standard limits that you're setting for it, and who's going to validate it, and the evaluation outcome of that, so that you can present to the management the performance of the overall HIRA control. Then comes personal protective equipment plan. Okay, you would have identified PPEs for significant, but to have a consistent approach of PPE application across the organization, we put a PPE plan, which is listing of different activities and trying to map what kind of PPEs, which grade, which make will help what kind of activity. So put a PPE plan like that. Competence is a huge element, which even includes awareness. So put a appropriate training plan with all the safety topics in it and frequency decided. And so that helps the organization to be aware of. Next is the health plan. Of course, you are in the health industry. The employees or contractors who are exposed to different types of hazards. Every hospital may have its own philosophy for a health plan which you may devise and practice it. MSDS, not waiting just for, you know, luckily you find an MSDS for the chemical, but instead put a systematic approach to gathering the MSDS, studying it, putting all the records of the MSDS in place. So that's what the management of chemical through MSDS we've spoken. And the legal register, one of the most important drivers, which is essential in the any industry for that matter, is legal compliance. So it's a business risk factor which we carry also when we don't comply to the legal requirements of the country. So to ensure that we have identified, we are aware of what we are complying to and whether we have complied or not. If not, then what is the action plan that we have put? So for that purpose, we maintain the legal register. So this is in summary how we identify the hazard, how we do the risk assessment, and how we do the establishment of controls. So I would just end it up by saying that it could not suffice any hospital if a Bible is created and just kept for purpose of reference. It has to be a dynamic document and it has to be kept up to date. That's an expectation internationally in any standard, in any country for that matter, to ensure the HIRA that is done, it is a live document and it's just not a dead document done for purpose of reference. So this is all from my side and we should be able to take any questions from here.
Keerthi, can you show them some checklist that can be helpful to them?
There could be some formats which will be of help.
Yes.
An example to show you the template. You can see that this sheet has multiple sheets of maybe 400 or 300. It goes like that. So the effort put in here is to see that we understand the activity. What kind of activity is happening, routine or non-routine activity? What is happening here? And which department are we doing this? What are the processes inside that? And then we get into the hazard, the multiple hazards. Each hazard may have risk associated. So identify the risk and see this risk is identified in what condition, that is in routine, non-routine or emergency. And then we say legal, is there any legal requirement applicable or not? Then we give scale factor. As I told, this is specific to type of hospital. You may wish to add few parameters. So here the addition is on scale factor. Scale is basically to say if at all there is a hazard happening, to what extent. So is it limited only to my workspace or it can go beyond my hospital? So 1 to 5, there is a grade. Severity and then probability of occurrence. And there's one more factor called present control we generally give. This is because I may already have good controls in place. So when I establish good controls, my severity may be still high, my probability may be low because of good controls. So to ensure that factor, we factor in present control, and then you have a multiplication factor, and then you have a criteria decided for significance. You would have still done your rating, but you may have some overriding criteria, maybe severity so-and-so and above, total score so-and-so and above, or if it's legal applicable, then it is significant. So to decide, so you will decide what is significant, and then here you will apply your hierarchy. In hierarchy, you decide what is the kind of control you want to go, and then you may even want to see the gap of what is available now and what you want to propose extra. So this is just one sample, but there are more than 50 ways of doing Hira. So what I've just shown you immediately is one of it. So maybe when we have a workshop, we will have some at least 3-4 exercises in different methods, which will help you understand it better.
So,
sir, on the legal, I would prefer to take it. Maybe we should have one webinar on legal requirements and we can share the related document then, if it's okay.
Okay. I think has been a wonderful session. Thank you very much, Keerthi. I don't think that we will be able to take up a lot many questions, but what I suggest is that you may send your questions to kaho.in over Gmail. We will forward it to Keerthi and we will try to answer them through the mail, as well as see that what other interaction we may be able to do with Keerthi on this subject. I am very, very convinced that a whole day program will be needed to understand this subject in greater depth. So thank you very much, Keerthi, and thank you all the people who have been a part today. This has been very illustrative, very illuminating, and thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you once again. Thanks for giving us the opportunity to share this. Thanks.